Hi, thanks for tuning in. I'm Ryan Brinkman, U.S. Automotive Equity Research Analyst for J.P. Morgan, and I'm here with Natasha Kaneva, Head of Metals Research and Strategy for J.P. Morgan Global Commodities Research. We're here to discuss a report recently released by Global Research regarding the outlook for the global electric vehicle market. Natasha, could you help to explain at a high level the vehicle electrification model that we have created? What does it encompass?
Thank you, Ryan. The underlying idea behind the report was that the average answers of a group of people is always more precise than the answer from each individual separately. So by definition, the larger the group of participants in a particular project and the more diverse this group is, then the lower the margin of error. So with that in mind, the report leverages the work of 14 different JP Morgan teams. For starters, we used the feedback or the numbers, the EV numbers given by us from five different auto equity teams, regional teams, one from the US, Europe, China, Japan, and South Korea. So those numbers then were adjusted by battery chemistries by three different regional teams from our other chemicals and battery chemicals teams, and then those numbers were further utilized by five different regional mining teams and the global commodity team to derive the demand numbers for metals. So the main conclusion from that report is that considering that all those inputs into the models were completely independent, the idea behind that was that because of that, the main output from the model is unbiased for any particular sector, any particular commodity, or any particular region. So with that in mind, actually the pulled number from the model showed a global EV penetration rate by 2025 of below 8%. This number is slightly more optimistic than the previous number published by JP Morgan on the global scale. The number is still quite conservative, what we're seeing from other sell side research banks. This number, we're pegging at around 10 to 14% penetration rate, so we are quite conservative in our estimates.
That's great, thanks. And the US team that I lead contributed to the model by estimating the trends for vehicle electrification in the North America region. Our thought process is that with the US administration's proposed relaxation of corporate average fuel economy standards, effectively capping them at 2021 levels instead of growing aggressively through 2025, as was previously planned under the earlier administration, that there may be less of an increase in battery electric vehicles in the North America market than might have been previously imagined, but at the same time, perhaps more growth in lesser degrees of electrification, for example, hybrids, plug-in hybrids, that also increase the efficiency of vehicles, but not as much and in a more cost-effective way. I'm curious what trends you were able to identify outside of the North America market. Where are battery electric vehicles, for example, expected to grow the most quickly? Which country in the world is expected to have the greatest concentration of these vehicles?
Correct. So I think one of the conclusions is that it's inevitable, it's coming. So I think there is no arguing about that, but at the same time, the pace of penetration will most likely be gradual, and we see this graduality in China. That's a very good example. The numbers are showing by 2025, still 84% of all the cars sold in China are actually not going to be in any form electrified. So there will be internal combustion engines. But at the same time, we see enough regional variance. And on the other side of the spectrum is, of course, Europe, where our forecasts are calling that by 2025, there will be no internal combustion engine vehicles sold at all. At the same time, I think what is interesting to point out is that while we still see a relatively low electrification rate coming out of China, at the same time, the battery electric vehicle penetration would be very high, just given the scale of production. But given the propensity of the Chinese automakers towards smaller battery packs, that does not necessarily result in a higher materials used in those battery packs.
I see. And with regard to the battery specifically, obviously a very important component in battery electric vehicles, what are the metals that are used most in the vehicles, and which metals are expected to increase the most going forward?
So what we're seeing is it's a very strong tendency from the battery producers is that technologies are moving very, very fast towards higher nickel chemistries in the battery packs at the cost of the cobalt. So it gives them higher energy density for sure, but at the same time, what allows the battery makers is to move away from cobalt, which is a metal considered with a problematic supply chain.
I see. And which are the metals that you see as having the most demand in 2025?
Considering our quite conservative penetration rate towards 2025, and when we feed all those models into our supply demand models, the answer is clearly it gives enough opportunity for the space to grow from the demand from the electric vehicles. But at the same time, the numbers I would have to say are relatively light compared to consensus. So in terms of the biggest usage out there, we still see lithium, for example. We see this year balanced market, but going forward, we don't see any shortages in lithium until at least mid of next decade. Very similar conclusion as in cobalt. It's a very well-supplied market, at least until 2023. Nickel is an interesting market because it sparks a lot of interest out there. We do see that demand will increase almost 10 times between now and 2025. We do believe that the prices will have to respond post-2020. And then there are metals which are not used in the batteries, but at the same time, they have to be employed if we're going to develop the sector, for example, to charge the electric vehicles. We need charging stations, which are extremely copper intensive. Then the cars have to become lighter. That's aluminum away from steel. So the PGM sector will get affected very strongly. The biggest loser, in our opinion, would be most likely platinum, and palladium would be the winner.
I see. And as you mentioned, a lot of industry observers believe that vehicle electrification is inevitable. Does it matter, though, how quickly the industry transitions to electrification for the metals market? And how much and how quickly do you think that the industry does electrify?
Yes, absolutely. So, again, the conclusion from the report was it's gradualism. Yes, it will happen gradually. We do believe that the inflection point will be past 2025. One of the points made during the process of coming up with the research was that we intentionally decided to make the cutoff date at 2025. Why? Because we have very little visibility beyond 2025. So if we had extended it towards 2030, most likely we would have like a hockey stick type of a penetration rate post-2025, which we decided not to do for now. So as long as we assume that the inflection point is past 2025, the miners still have plenty of time to react and to come up with more supply to satisfy the demand. If we assume that it's moving closer to us, for example, 2020, 2021, then there is no time for them to react because looking just at the capital expenditure in the space, it peaked in 2013 and it has not increased since then. So pretty much what it means is that there will be shortages and the prices would have to respond accordingly.
That's great. Thank you very much, Natasha. And thank you everyone else also for tuning in. To learn more, visit jpmorgan.com.